Welcome to my talk about product security team. I will be giving a security overview of what we are doing here in the year 2022. My name is Markus Meissner. I'm project manager for security, also distinguished engineer for solution security here at SUSE, part of the bigger security team. What I will be talking about is give a brief introduction to the SUSE product security team, what we are doing. I will be looking back at the first half of this year and the last year. I will be talking briefly about how closing the leap gap has affected our work, what was good, what was bad. We'll be talking a bit about supply chain security at SUSE, because that is a topic that is on our minds these days in a very big fashion, and give some outlooks and call for actions at the end. So let's start with introducing the team. Our team lead, head of product security, is Stoyan Manolov. We have the team split in two parts. We have the reactive side. You can think of that as incident response, handling CVEs, similar topics. There, I'm project manager in a project management role. We have also several security engineers, also here today at the conference, Alexander Bergmann, Robert Frohl, Gianluca Gabrielli, Carlos Lopez, Gabriele Sonu, Thomas Leroy, sadly not at our conference because the French conference was parallel at this time. We have Martin, Martin Ray, and Kefi Hu. And we also have a trainee currently, Michael Muschner. We also have the proactive side of security, so the second part of the team that handles audits and so on. The lead of this sub-team is Johannes Segitz, and it has also following security engineers Matthias Gerstner, Wolfgang Frisch, Paolo Perego, Filippo Bonazzi. All of them are here at the conference, excepting Thomas. If you see us, say hi. Feel free to approach us. Again, what is proactive versus reactive doing? Reactive is handling the incident response. Basically, we review all the CVEs, we track them, coordinate it, and monitor that. But we also have time on working on other projects, on proactive side projects or regular packaging work or similar. The proactive team is responsible for security before product shipment. So they audit programs, system services, network services, system D services, DBus profiles, and so on. They also approve product releases. So just recently, they approved the 15.4 OpenSUSE Leap release. So in general, they do all the security work before shipment so that we don't need to fix it afterwards. And recently, they have been doing more and more as a Linux work. So we not just have Johannes as our subject matter expert, but we also have Filippo and also Kefi is helping with as a Linux. So talking a bit about reactive security, we react on all reported security issues. They can come from automated databases, which is 99% of that, come over security at SUSE.de or any other reporting forum to us. As it is quite an amount of updates that come in, we have separate roles called incident managers and update managers. The incident managers handle the incoming side, and the update managers handle the actual package updates. Our responsibility is in coordinating the handling of CVEs from begin to end, but we are not responsible for fixing or testing them. So we delegate the fixing to the package maintainers, the source review to the OBS or IBS review teams, and the testing to our QA teams on QA automation. But we are responsible for releasing them, the updates, and if there's need for documentation, we are responsible for this documentation, both the human and the machine readable forms. So incident management, just quickly, how does it work? We open a bug for you in Bugzilla. If you're a packager, you will have seen that probably with a standardized summary line, while-0 or while-1, CVID, source package name, and a short summary. We always open them in a SUSE Security Incidents product, occasionally also for OpenSUSE, only issues in OpenSUSE distribution product space, but mostly in SUSE Security Incidents, which is a public readable product. So you can look at all security bugs without logging in. We put in, of course, descriptions, references, links, patches, and report users, attach them to the bug as we have them available, and assign that to the packager or bug owner to get it fixed on time. Internally, we have a separate tool called Smash that helps us with rating, CVSS-free scoring, so that stores the ratings and scores, and also stores the affected software for Azure Linux Enterprise. So we can say, for instance, glibc on slash 12 is affected by something or not affected on slash 15, so that this is available before to customers, or that we can use in our monitoring and tracking so that we see where fixes are still missing or where fixes are, have been already been done. A bit of statistics already. A very long-running query of mine that runs once a week checks the opened security bugs every week from 2006 to 2022. You see here, in the first years, we had around 11, 12, around with quite some noise until 2014. Then it gets very spiky. That was the time where American fuzzy lob fuzzing became very prominent against graphics libraries and similar tools. And these peaks in the 2017-2016 range are largely coming from extensive fuzzing of existing open source libraries. We have a bit of a gap as we transition from Micro Focus to SUSE standalone, as the actual cron job that does the stats was not running and I didn't notice for some months. But these days, you see we are around at 30, 35 medium or average rate of bugs every week. So our work has quite increased over time. Update management, as mentioned, the packager submits updates to us, be it on OpenSUSE side, be it on IBS side. The security team writes a bit of metadata around it, standardized summary line, semi-formal description with CVE texts, and a machine-readable issues list where we list the CVEs, where we list the Bugzilla numbers and Jira tickets. We check if it builds, if dependencies are met, and push it over to QA. QA tests the update, both manually and also machine with automation, mostly OpenQA these days. And the security team in the end releases the update and potentially does additional documentation work. What we deliver in the end is, of course, the updates. That's the base. We also deliver notifications for every update. For SLES, we both per email on SLE updates, SLE security updates, and on the website. For OpenSUSE, we send emails to securitynouns@list.opensuse.org, and it can be also looked at in a web archive of lists. We generate auto-generate information, CVE pages, more human-readable, overall data, CVF data, more machine-readable, two different formats that can be used by standardized tooling. For CVF, a common vulnerability reporting format, we generate two styles, one per advisory, so every advisory is converted into this XML format for processing by ticket systems or similar. But we also, meanwhile, this year started generating per CVE CVF data. So if you want to use and import our CVE data in a machine-readable fashion, we offer this in a CVF data. It's a bit more complex than perhaps than even scraping web pages because the standard body was making it very complex, but I will see that we have more and better readable formats in the future. One special thing I want to talk about where we need to do more documentation are so-called high-impact vulnerabilities. You saw we handle a lot of issues every week, and so we can't really do much for every of those. Yeah? But some of those shine out. Some of those are in the press. Some of those managers ask about, and so on. Things like the codenamed vulnerabilities, Heartbleed, Shellshock, Meltdown, and so on. And for us, they need two kinds of actions. The technical action, the quick delivery of updates, so quick reaction to this issue, and more documentation and more communication. Occasionally also tricky fixes, but the communication and documentation part is also important because it has a tendency of humans, of managers, and they want to be informed. They want to be assured that SUSE is handling them, how we handle them, if they are affected, how big, how bad it is, and so on. So it's really a special category for us. We have, for them, we have like 15 every year. And we have a bit of a special process around them and also a special team if you need to deliver updates quickly, the so-called emergency update team. So much for the reactive side. For the proactive security side, as mentioned, they make products secure before shipment, so part of the secure development lifecycle at SUSE. They run a lot of automation during build, and if you are a packager, you probably already have a build getting failed because of that. So set UID binaries, debug services, policy kit rules, PAM modules, and more need to be whitelisted. So if you add a new one, your build will fail and you will need to get to us. You need to come to the security team. We will audit the package, whitelist if it's good, and you can proceed with the submitting the package. And of course, they also look at some whatever comes up, whatever feels weird and needs auditing. The work entirely is based on factory development. So as SLES has a factory first policy, everything that comes into SLES was in factory before. So the factory development helps us here that we get to the security reviews when they are needed, when the version comes in, and not just in a big blob when the next SLES service pack is done. We base the work on packages. But we also, of course, look at the final product with with security scanning and other tools like Linus and so on. So most of the actually SUSE Linux Enterprise work is done in OpenSUSE, OpenSUSE Factory, and Tumbleweed. So quick look back at the last year. I made some stats. Sadly, they are not really showing any big trends. So, but generally, we note for around 2,500 plus minus CVEs if we are affected, if we do some fixes or not on our CVE pages. We actually release updates for around 2,000 CVEs every year, both SLE and OpenSUSE. And we release in all together updates around 2,200, 2,300 updates per year. out of OpenSUSE, there was a bit more overlap between, depending on how much overlap between OpenSUSE releases is, as you see, we average around 850. In 2022, it's a bit less if you look at the trend because we now import much more updates or we release much more updates with closing the leap gap methods. So I don't count them separately or I don't count them for OpenSUSE anymore. Also looking back at the last year, high impact vulnerabilities, log4shell, challenge there was, it was really the most, or the biggest problem we ever faced. So I don't remember anything bigger right now. And the problem was that it is a Java jar. It was embedded in other packages. And identifying all those packages was a challenge. And doing this very quickly, of course. We had the second iteration of boothole, the secure boot issues. Nothing after the first round, it was not so bad anymore because we knew what we needed to do. There's one issue, they're called Diffie-Hellman ITER, DH-ITER, which exploits actually the Diffie-Hellman key exchange mathematics. So it is not an exploitation of code, but actually of the protocol. And that is kind of really hard to solve with, and our recommendation was for there only to switch off Diffie-Hellman key exchange and only rely on elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman at this time, because even though it has a similar weakness, it's not so bad as the Diffie-Hellman weakness. So here we see that really would need a change in TLS and a TLS protocol to really fix it, and that is definitely not easily possible. Some other code names appeared. You can look them up on our TID pages. This year, also Dirty Pipe, PwnKit, trivial root exploits. Even today, we find these kind of things. Even remote code execution in Samba with the Fruit VFS module. And last year, this year, and probably all the next years in the future, more CPU side channel issues. And of course, the year is not over yet. We don't know what it will bring, and there likely will be more code words at the end of the year. Some highlights from the proactive side. The proactive team worked together with, I think, Martin Lischka to switch to RPM Lint 2, which helps the RPM Lint checks to make them more standard or make them better integratable. They added more whitelisting methods, lock rotate scripts, RPM post and pre scripts, and they actually added hashes of these kind of config files so that if you change a config file, they take another look at it if it's still okay. That in turn, of course, a lot of audits happened on a lot of packages. I don't have the exact number, but around 40 to 50 happened over the last year. What changed in factory? We now use full RELRO support with -z now since some weeks. So parts of the ELF binary hardening. And factory now supports crypto policies so that you have a central place to switch off SHA-1 or TLS 1.0 or some things. Still, applications need to be ported to that. And we have been picking up more SELinux work as we have more SELinux knowledge on staff. Closing the leap gap, OpenSUSE, interesting, up to from 42 over 15.0 to 15.2. We imported and rebuilt all the SLES updates. So we imported the SLES sources once they got released, pushed them to a separate maintenance pipeline with QA, source review. And also the similar thing happened for Sleep Package Hub that imported stuff from OpenSUSE Leap 15.2 into Package Hub. Both were separate rebuild processes, and of course, this causes delays, build times, double QA, build problems, etc. And especially visible was with Mozilla Firefox, and we repeatedly had complaints that Firefox was taking too long to release. And of course, we always needed to handhold updates, make it build, even though they already had passed this last build and maintenance pipeline. And last but not least, the origin manager used was designed for GA development and not really for maintenance, so it was kind of fragile. With 15.3 and now 15.4, we, instead of rebuilding stuff, we shipped SLE binaries directly. They are shipped at the same time as SLE. It's actually the same, at the exact same time. Also, Package Hub is now shared between SLE and OpenSUSE. There is no source rebuild anymore. It was a bit of a rough start for 15.3. We had our first method that we used was not working, so we switched to a new method, but that is now working quite well. And for OpenSUSE maintenance, it means much less effort than before. So we need to process much less updates than before. So we use a lot of the efforts from SLES also to provide for OpenSUSE Leap 15.3 and 4. So some words about supply chain security. Someone of my colleagues made this graphic at some point, and it expresses this nice chain quite a bit simplified, but basically, we take in community code, we look at the code, we review the code, we select actually what packages we ship, more so for SLES than for Tumbleweed, because in Tumbleweed, if something builds, usually it gets accepted. We build the packages, we test the packages with OpenQA, or internally, the packages getting signed and delivered to the delivery network. In IBS, with a content delivery network, with an OpenSUSE over the mirror framework that we are using, over to our users and also customers. And all this in the box is either, you can think of this either as SUSE or the OpenSUSE build service. So where are the challenges? Where are the challenges here? And the biggest challenge I see is trusting the incoming sources. So we take sources from thousands of open source developers. And it's a very diverse ecosystem. There are some old school GNU people that wrote software 20 years ago that is still in use today, but there are also quite recent newcomers or rapidly changing packages like Node.js or Chromium or whatever you have. And it's also ranging from the one guy in his basement to really big companies delivering source code. So how do we And our task is that we ensure that the maintainer was the one providing the sources and they were not tampered with in between. So how do we solve that today? We use source URLs so that we can re-download the same tarball again and can verify if it changed. We store the tarballs internally in the build service, so we will notice if something changed. But these source URLs were largely they are largely now already HTTPS, but we still have HTTP, FTP, even in services old Git protocol, or even no source URL. So we don't even know where this tarball actually came from. The solution up to now for really cryptographic strength signing was GPG signatures, but sadly this is kind of rare. So not many package developers publish GPG signatures for their tarballs. And with JIT services, again, there are unsafe Git protocols. The old Git protocol is plaintext, also HTTP plaintext. So we have not dig much deeper into the Git services, how to avoid these plaintext protocols. But the good thing is we store all the tarballs in OBS. So if someone gets modified, or if we have someone tells this is now a good tarball, we would always be able to compare if we have the good or the bad one. How do we want to change that, or what should change? So we need to bring up the usage of HTTPS source URLs and also GPG signatures. GPG is tricky to handle, I get that, so that might be challenging. Perhaps use more Git storage, more Git services with its implicit hash integrity and also GPG signing of commits. Or even look at better signing methods, like for instance the Zixdor.dev signing methods. There is, of course, thankfully, we have a bit of the central hosting sites like GitHub. And if GitHub would decide, yeah, we offer this service of signing, then it would solve the problem for a lot of or high percentage of the software ecosystem at once. And here, you as a packager can help us. If you have a package, check if the source URL is HTTPS. Johannes submitted some spec cleaner work that tries to convert it automatically. And if we don't reference GPG signatures, but if there is one, please add one, and so we can rely on this checking in the future. The next one is building the updates. And recently, Google published a standard or a draft standard called SALSA, SLSA, that basically describes how to securely build from sources so that people can be ensured that this build was not compromised, not influenced by outside parties. So really, to really focus on these kind of build-side supply chain attacks. They focus on 4 points: sources, building, provenance, and common methods. And we take a look at it and compared the gap analysis. And here the Open Build Service is really shining already. So what we did with the Open Build Service, how we moved with that, it really helps us to also achieve the highest SALSA level requirements. Already. We had to do some process adjustments. So two-person reviews were enforced only by policy and not by technology. So we changed that. Really, it's now mandatory that there are two persons reviewing source submissions. And we will get strong user authentication for IBS and OBS. So for our internal build service, it will become mandatory. For the open build service, at the first, we will be having this only optionally, so that you have your Google Authenticator or similar tooling as a second factor for logging into the build service. What is new with SALSA is provenance. What does provenance mean is you prove to the outside how you actually build the package. So in OBS, you can look at the build log, you can extract the build environment, but it's not standardized and it's not fully complete. There has been development in the SALSA framework or in the related frameworks of something called in-toto attestation. And there is that basically is a JSON file that describes exactly what package were used for building, what sources were used for building, what parameters were passed into the data, who built it, and so on. And it's signed and published to the outside. So if you look at builds today, you will see some form of Salsa provenance.json files beside your package binaries that describe that already contain this provenance data. This is so the target goal of this is even to go to the fact that you could actually reproduce the build on the outside with this provenance file, even without the build service. What is missing is actually reproducible builds. So Salsa also has optionally currently reproducible builds, a topic that Bernhard Wiedemann is focusing quite strongly on here at SUSE. And I think he has a workshop tomorrow in the morning. But currently we are, due to the nature of RPM signatures, we are not able to really reproduce RPMs in a bitwise fashion. So the delivery part of the supply chain focuses largely around cryptographic signatures. What do we do today? Today we sign RPMs, we sign repository metadata, and we sign ISO metadata with GPG. We sign UEFI secure boot binaries, and we sign containers with Notary, Atomic, and Cosign on the registry. Registry SUSE.com with with the free methods, and I think the registry OpenSUSE.org only with the first two. There are some challenges there. How do you know it is the right OpenSUSE key that you have? We are no longer handing out a physical media to you. So it's a bit challenging to how do you know that it's the real OpenSUSE medium? And of course, with OBS and also Pacman, we have a lot of third-party repos. How do you know that it really is the right third-party repo that you are adding? Because they all have different keys, and do you know if it's the right key or not? So this is a bit of an open challenge for that. What is missing in the whole cryptographic signature scheme? Container signature verification. If you look at the current ecosystem, it's always optional, never enforced, and must be separately configured. Kubernetes started doing Cosign from Zixtor Cosign verification now. Not sure if it's default, but it is still a big problem. You largely rely that the HTTPS transfer from the registry is not tampered with in the middle. So this is something to improve. And also what I see in lots of image builds, lots of container builds, is that options like no GPG checks or GPG auto import keys is passed to Zipper or similar flex to Kiwi. And that these options mean there is no signature checking done. You trust any key or you ignore the checks. So please stop doing that. Please rely on signature checking there. Please switch. You do the extra work of verifying the package signatures also for container and image builds. So Zixtor, I mentioned it before, is an additional new initiative under the Linux Foundation umbrella, which we started to support in various flavors. And its target is to make signing of any kind of artifacts easier, sources, binaries, images, containers, whatever. So they started with Cosign, container signing, new method there. They also work with keyless or short-term key signing with short-lived keys during automated builds. For instance, if you build on GitHub, you don't want to store a long-term key on your GitHub instance, but they now invented a method where the build is associated with your user account with a temporary key signed by by another authority, by they call Fulcio, so another CA, and to verify this, these kind of builds, they are stored in a transparency log file. So the transparency log file is also part of the Zixtor umbrella framework, and it's basically an append-only signature log, just an endless log. There's one from the Linux Foundation, but you can also set up your own. What is SUSE doing currently? We sign our containers on the registry SUSE.com, but not the OpenSUSE.org yet. we store the repository metadata and the container signatures in the Recore log from the Linux Foundation. And as mentioned, yes, it's currently not done on the OBS side. And what we are also planning is to do verification in system against the Recore log if the signature is present in the log file. With that, some final words. What security will be doing this year? We, of course, will continue to do our regular audit work, our regular incident response work, and product improvements. We will do a lot of work on the adaptive Linux platform, so the next generation enterprise server, enterprise Linux, and of course, work more on a supply chain hardening topics. And where can you help us as an OpenSUSE packager, OpenSUSE contributor? If you spot any security issue that doesn't have a CVE yet, please tell us. If it has a CVE, it will arrive on our desk in some form already. If you think we have missed it, please also contact us. But usually, if it has a CVE, we get to know it. But if you see one without CVE, please come to us. We will get a CVE. So even if you find an own security issue, we can help you assign CVEs and so on. As a packager, as mentioned, feel free to adjust source URLs, RGPG signatures to packages. And also for any cryptographic package user, please increase the crypto policies adoption. There has been a talk from the crypto policies maintainer some years ago here at this conference. I think it should be still on YouTube. If you want to have an introduction, there's also a page on the OpenSUSE Wiki about that. That said, if you want to contact us, security@suse.de, our landing page is suse.com/security, and we are always looking for people or students that can do work for us. With that, I would take questions. There's one in the back.
Please wait for the microphone.
The microphone is coming. Thorsten is running.
Yeah, thank you, Markus. Very interesting. I have one question. Every now and then we have the situation that a package is vulnerable, a fix is released, a fix is brought into Tumbleweed, and we're very happy about it. But for Leap, we cannot release it because it needs a higher version of the underlying framework like Python 3.8 or something like that. How do you deal with these issues?
Yeah, this is tricky. It's usually an integration problem. Yeah. But I have no good answer for that. I mean, it's the usual way we would deal with these kind of version updates. But for SLES, we try to backport security fixes, and most security fixes are backportable. So.
Yeah,
that might be a short-term solution, but for the bigger part, for more integration part, that's something where we also delegate to the integration team, so the OpenSUSE factory team, Dominic, and so on.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
More questions? Yeah. So if there are no more questions, I'm at the conference today and tomorrow, or just reach out. We are happy. I'm happy. We are happy to answer questions. Thank you.